Thank you very much for coming today. I was born in Poland, so my first language was Yiddish at home. And we spoke Polish on the street, but you can imagine a six-year-old child wouldn't spend too much time on the street. And you don't start school in Poland until you're seven. So my primary language was Yiddish. And then we came to Israel when I was six, 7 years old, and we were in Israel for 3 years. And then our American family signed for us, and we came to the great Mecca of Memphis, Tennessee. Memphis, Tennessee, if you don't think that was a shock. Anyway, as it happens, today, of course, I realized that we settled in a place which is considered the wrong side of the tracks. But at that time, of course, I didn't know. But there was an interesting microcosm of people there because Memphis is a big city that has a smaller city next to it called Millington, which used to be a naval base, a big naval base. So a lot of the officers and various people from that service came and settled in our neighborhood after they retired. And then there were just generally people that had done well and weren't doing so well presently, and people that had been part of the vaudeville shows, and just a wonderful association of people that you just couldn't have asked for a better replica of what America looked like. In any case, one of the ladies that was there was an old vaudevillian, and she had a trunk full of beautiful costumes that were handmade for her, and she was, I'm sure, ancient, 60 or 70 years old at that time. And she would take her costumes out, and she spoke with this very heavy and broad Irish accent, and I just thought that was English. I didn't really know that that was Irish. And she would say to me, "Me name's O'Reilly, but I'm proud to say me mother's a MacDonald." Well, I was pretty impressed with that because I love that music. There was music in her English, so I would just come home, "My name's O'Reilly." Anyway, so my brothers and I always, we all had individual jobs. I did the voice imitations. One of my brothers used to imitate people walking with bad legs. The other one used to take apart everything, and then the other brother used to put things together that the other one took apart. But what happened with this woman was because she was so entertaining and that the fact that I liked to listen to her talk, she would also tell me these wonderful stories about how her mother liked to make peace with people. She said, "You know, me mother," she would say to her neighbor, "Oh, Ethel, why don't we forget our differences and go and have a paint?" So this is all I was learning, and across the street I saw somebody that was formerly an officer, and he was raising his children according to the military tradition, so that every time he'd say something to his son, he'd say, "Did you hear me? Did you hear me, son?" And the son would say, "Yes, sir! Yes, sir." Well, this was so odd to all of us that we had no idea what to do. Eventually, September came around, and we had to go to school. So the principal, of course, is a very southern guy. And I said to him, he says to me, "What is your name?" I said, "My name is Bela Wrodowski." He said, "I'll make you Bela. You'll be Bela, like Bela Cotton." I said, "Okay." Anyway, that's my name, Bela. He writes my name. And then he says to me, "And what are your parents' names?" And I said, "Well, I'm proud to say that me mother is an O'Reilly and me father is a MacDonald." He said, "Well, it says here that your mother's name is Sarah Shankman and your father's name is Herschel Wlodowski. How do you explain those differences?" And I said, "Well, why don't we have a pint and forget our differences?" That was one tough year, let me tell you. Because the next thing that happened was he was looking at me and he said, "Are you sassing me? Are you sassing me?" All I knew was it was a question. And to that, I was supposed to say, "Yes, sir!" Today, fortunately, you can see I did learn to speak English. And I am also a woman of few words. You'll be thankful for that. Yeah, alavai. Shalom Aleichem, who gave the Yiddish world two things that you didn't have to buy, because most everybody that was living in the Pale of Settlement, which we will talk about tomorrow, and that part of the world that most of our families came from, most of the 5 million people that were living under Tsarist Russia, about 97% of them had to live in the Pale of Settlement. And the Pale of Settlement was specifically designed to impoverish the Jews. As that was the case, mission accomplished. So one of the most important things that Shalom Aleichem gave to the Jewish public was two things you didn't have to buy: laughter and faith. And he did it by creating an important character called Tevye, who speaks for him. Imagine, a lot of people call Yiddish jargon as a way of putting it down, but it could not possibly be more an expert language than it is, because it has borrowed from every language in the world. When the Jews were dispersed all over the world 2,000 years ago, the diaspora is from a Greek word which means dispersion of seeds. It just so happens that most of the Jews were living in this part of the world that was known as Ashkenaz. The ancient world for Germany is Ashkenaz. Consequently, about 5 million people became Ashkenazim. But what happens with them is that they were congregated in an area, because from the north or south of the Pale of Settlement, it was about 1,000 miles. And across, it was somewhere from 350 to 500 miles across. Consequently, it was quite a large place, and this is one of the reasons that we have so many dialects of Yiddish. The dialects in Yiddish are exactly like the dialects that you would hear, that you would recognize right away as South Philly, as Boston, even as Newton, as Brooklyn, as Bronx. All of these locations are relatively close, but they have very significant dialectical differences. And this is the exact same thing that happened in the Yiddish world. The Yiddish language began in the part of the world that has been debated and fought over for many, many years, and that is the place that is known as Alsace-Lorraine. Alsace-Lorraine was sometimes French, sometimes German, and in general you can say that there are even still some Latin words in Yiddish because of the location of where they were. So if you say, for example, a Yiddish sentence like Nuchen Benchen Vetter Zede Koifen a Sefer, after Benchen, after the benediction, the Zede, which comes from the European Eastern languages, Koifen is German, a Sefer is from Hebrew. So you can see that even in one sentence, you can have these various words that come together that play a very important role. The Jewish people generally began to educate their little boys at the age of 3. If the little boys had been toilet trained at the age of 2, they would have started at the age of 2. But they could consider that by the age of 3, the rabbi wouldn't have to attend to them. These little boys went to the rabbi's cheder. They went to his one-room house, and a house, one room, is a cheder. So they went to the cheder. They went to study with the rabbi, and little girls were not educated until, say, the beginning of the 20th century. That Yiddish became the mother tongue, the mama loshen, which comes from mama lashon, mother's tongue. The mother tongue was used so that people wouldn't have to talk about everyday activities using a holy language, which was Hebrew. So the mama loshen then, that language, was something that was very simple. It would be something like pidgin English in a way. It would be something that begins on a very simple level, replicating Germanic words. This is like Middle High German, one of the dialects that was spoken in that part of the world. The German language continued to expand and change in sound and in the way that it elevated, because the Germans were able to go all over the world and their life expanded in a different way, considerably different way than the Yiddish world, as the Yiddish world tended to be ghettoized. So they kept that same sound, and it was a more mellow kind of sound, kind of a sweeter sound. Yiddish is sweeter than German. So they became so highly educated, as you know, literacy is transferable. Jews are very important. They're integral to building people's economy at a time when most of the world is illiterate, and little boys from the age of 3, by the time that they're 13 years old, can do many, many things, as they have been sitzenaffen banken. They have been sitting on the benches from 7 in the morning till 9 at night. So they became so highly educated, as you know, literacy is transferable. So Jews became very, very important to keep books, to do all of those important things that a person would do to keep an economy either beginning or rolling. So Casimir invited the Jews to come there. They wanted a safe haven. He invited them to come there, and he had a very positive view of the Jews in particular, since I think one of his courtesans was Jewish. But no matter that case or not, he welcomed them so that they could help to build his country up. Now, what happened at that juncture in the 1400s-1500s is, and through the beginnings of the Yiddish language, say the year 1000 or so, women, because they had no education, because they were schooled a little bit in writing and reading Yiddish, wanted to read romance novels. They wanted to read novels that told them about knights and damsels in distress and all of the things that other women would have read in the greater culture. In fact, there was a famous series called Bove the Great Knight. Of course, the Crusades were not friends of the Jews, so eventually they made it into a Bove Meise. So the Bove Meise became just a friendlier way to convey these kind of stories, and women were highly entertained by this, I guess what we would call pulp fiction. They were highly entertained by it. In later years, if you have people that are literary around, they want to read, and they will want to read anything. Consequently, when the printing press was invented around the 1400s-1500s, they became one of the most important groups of people that wanted to purchase literature that was being printed. Not only the literature, say the Hebrew books that were being printed, because at this point you could actually own a Torah in your own home, and it would be relatively inexpensive to replicate as opposed to making a Torah scroll. So people would have those kind of books that they desired desperately to own, their own Torah, so that they could read it at their leisure and enjoy it, and there was a huge demand for these kind of books. Now, women at some juncture also wanted to know what the Torah said, so there were scholars that wrote in Yiddish and wrote all around the boundaries, effectively, of those books, explaining in Yiddish what was being said in Hebrew. And even another way for the publishers to make more money, because then they continued publishing, the center part was in Hebrew, and the outside was were replications of Rashi, some of the writings of Rashi in Aramaic. There were all kinds of notations in Yiddish, and it became very much a sought-after kind of book to own, and consequently publishing took off like mad. And the Jews, since they're literate, are the ones that are purchasing most of these books. This is one of the reasons that the Italian peninsula became wealthy, outside of the fact that everything was going for it. Everything in the world that could be going right went right in the Italian world when they were experiencing the Renaissance, and one of those things was publication industry. A lot of it founded in Florence. And this was done by a non-Jew who was being educated by a Jew. In any case, what happens is, I have been lucky enough to study the arts now for 10 or 12 years, and I have figured out a few things. I've come to a few conclusions which might be erroneous, but I'm pretty sure I could argue you down if you came to me and challenged me. Because what I'm understanding is, I am self-educated, which doesn't mean anything really, because today anyone can be self-educated with DVDs and the teaching company and VCD, everything is available. So it's not so hard to be educated, you just have to be interested. The conclusion that I've come to is, literature is probably one of the most important art forms that can ever be created, because the written word can travel the world. The written word is also far less expensive than paintings and sculpture and architecture. Consequently, literature becomes an essential way that people learn how to shape their lives. We know this. This is why the Torah was written. It's teaching you how to live your life. What will happen, of course, is, as the world changes because of American revolutions and French revolutions, there will be an inversion of who is the important person. It will no longer be the 1% that are part of the monarchy entitled landed gentry. It will become those people that never had a voice that spoke for them. And that will become known as the personal novel. The first personal novel that was printed was Daniel Defoe's Robinson Crusoe. Thank you, I forgot. Ich vergesse ein bisschen. Anyway, so Robinson Crusoe. Robinson Crusoe was such a runaway success that authors that wanted to write thought, bam, they've got great ways to begin to write things that people are going to want to buy. Well, so Robinson Crusoe is still connected to kind of a religious, there's a religious sentiment there. However, what happens is, it introduces a brand new genre of writing. Because it does, and because Jews are literary people already, What will happen is a lot of Jewish people that are not supposed to be reading, because as you know, most of the people that lived in the Pale of Settlement for a long, long time were the Hasidim. They didn't want new information. They didn't want you looking at other philosophies. In fact, they wanted to protect the way that you thought. They wanted it to be narrow, but of course it is very broad because there are so many books that are written that are religious books. However, they did not want you to be exposed to a lot of new ideas, which might create a revolution in their own monarchies. Hasidism is a monarchy all its own. There's no way to stop a good idea. And what will happen is, then we will have the introduction of the work by Jane Austen. We will have Charlotte and Emily Bronte. We will have all of these stories of people that are trying to work their way up. And if they are the ones coming up, then the ones that are up are coming down. So this kind of inversion is an important way that the world will make a turn. There is a secularization of the Jewish world that happens in the 1800s. So that someone like Shalom Aleichem would have read and written and translated the greatest authors of their time. He would have translated Dostoevsky to Yiddish. He would have been introduced to every kind of personal novel, every kind of philosophy in the world. And as you know, the newspapers that were printed in the Pale of Settlement made everyone else in the world pale compared to them. Because you had revolutionaries, and you had traditionalists, and you had conservatives, and you had Zionists. In one city, in Warsaw, there were 26 papers a day that were being printed. All of them from different ways of presenting the Yiddish world, encouraging people how they can either become secularized, or perhaps why they should stay religious. But these various accounts of what happens, as you know, most novels begin their life in newspapers, serialized, because that is an inexpensive way for an author to print and for people to acquire the information. It happens with Shalom Aleichem, who, by the way, was highly, highly, highly educated. He wrote in Russian, he wrote in Hebrew, and he wrote in Ukrainian. But he didn't want anyone to know who he was in the Yiddish world, so he took a pen name and he named himself Shalom Aleichem. He took a pen name just in case the work did not go over well. In particular, since Yiddish was not considered an appropriate language with which to write good literature. It was just a mamaloshen. What happened with these great authors in the 1800s is they will expand the Yiddish dictionary exponentially. Every year there will be more and more and more words because they will have to redefine the world that is many thousands of years old with a modern eye, using a language that is very old with a modern eye. So what does Shalom Aleichem do to give Yiddish credibility? What does he do? You think he's a fool? You think he's a fool? He's a genius beyond geniuses. He goes to Homer! He goes to Homer! He goes to the Iliad and the Odyssey, which is the foundation for Western literature. He cannot create a character around Achilles. Because Achilles does not promote culture. He's too destructive. So he goes to Odysseus. He goes to Odysseus. Because he knows that the way that the Greek world is constructed means the same thing to everyone. How is the Greek world constructed? There are choices that each of us make every single day that are based pretty much on five principles. One of them is, how do you define yourself as a person in respect to God or a higher power? How do you define yourself and how do you interact with your community and your family? And then, of course, the most complex way that you interact with yourself is, what do you do when no one's looking? So what is your relationship with your conscience? That's three things: your God, your community and family, and yourself. And every single day, the way that we negotiate our lives, we have two other choices we make as well. Are we going to act like a primitive wild man like Achilles? Or are we going to think twice about what we do because we're civilized people like Odysseus? The adventures that take place in his life, he is a stranger in a strange land, and he must learn how to negotiate all of these things in good humor to save his life. Tevye does the same thing. Tevye is a stranger in a strange land. He is a Jew living under the Tsarist Empire, in which anti-Semitism is part of the way that government works. It's institutionalized anti-Semitism, because like Shalom Aleichem said, a Jew was worth a zero with a hole in it, because he was always in danger in that way. And he had to put his wits to use every single day that he left his home so that he could return to his beloved Golda. This is what a civilized man is.